technical side. So is it everyone here from a computer science background? Like, you guys have some experience working, or is it completely that you've just done some masters in some other technology?
Actually, this is Karthik here. I did my master's in mechanical, sorry, bachelor's in mechanical engineering and master's in industrial engineering. I don't have that much knowledge in computer science, but I have a little knowledge right now.
Okay, no problem. What about others?
Yeah, hi, this is Jonathan. I did my master's in electrical and electronics engineering.
Okay.
The Linux, just the Linux. There's.
Okay, so Linux administration or Linux essentials.
Yeah, just the basic Linux.
Okay, that should be enough.
Yeah, did my master's. There's.
Okay, good enough. What about others? Vishwa, Akhil.
This is Akhil, and I'm from computer science. My bachelor's in computer science and my master's in computer science.
Okay, thank you.
So this is Vishwa. So I did my master's in electrical engineering, and I have like some knowledge on scripting languages, and then I have done a certificate course on SAP BI. So, yeah.
Okay.
Krishna, and I've done my master's in electrical engineering, but I have a concept of computer networking because that was my.
Okay.
Hi, this is Shavanti, and I too did both my master's and bachelor's in computer science.
Okay, that's good. Thank you again. So, I do see like we do have a mix. So, many of you guys are from electrical background, and a few of you guys have a computer science background. Okay, anyway, so the reason why I asked is like I just wanted to know so that I can talk in that way, it will be more understandable. So let me talk in a general layman terms so that it will be clear on what is that we are trying to do. So what I'll be doing is I'll be walking you guys through the details about what is the so-called DevOps, what are the things that people do in DevOps, or why is it helpful so that if a company implements it, what are the advantages, and then we'll see what is the kind of work that a person who's going to work in that will be doing, what tools will be working, and then finally, as a course, what are the things that we can do in it. Okay. So before starting, let me introduce myself. My name is Adam, and I'm basically I was into build and release initially for close to 10 years, and then now moved on to DevOps because the IT is completely moving into the automation, and that is how I'm here. Okay, Shri, or can someone mute because I just hear some background noise. Okay, that's better. Can you guys go on mute because I just hear some background. Okay, that's better. Thank you. All right, so let's get started. Now, if you take a company, okay, a product company or a specific service company who want to work on a kind of product that may be internal product or external product. So what will happen is, so if you divide the people who are in the company, you can basically segregate them based on the amount of work they are doing and the type of work they are doing. So how can you segregate? In a bigger picture, you can segregate as a group of people who are writing code and trying to develop the product. So we call them generally as developers. And on the other side, the major community would be on the people who would be testing it. So that is what we call them as QA. So development and the QA people together form the major part of the product group. And on the other side, if you take So in order to support these guys who are working on the development and QA, we will be having certain people into the administration or operations who will be making sure that all the machines or all the servers which each of the individual in the development and QA are using is working fine. So that is how you can divide it into a bigger picture, because I'm not going to get into very minute level, but on a higher level, if you say, you can take it as a development group wherein we have people who are working on the coding, that is developers, and people who are doing the testing called QA. And on the other side, if you take, you can segregate them as an operation teams, which means people who maintain the server and work on the server, and they are basically into the world of servers completely. They don't care about the development or testing. So that is how we can segregate it. Now, why is that we have to do? Because let's see how DevOps is going to help, or what is DevOps and what is the things that we can do. So in order to see, let us understand what are the pain points or what are the problems that people are facing in the industry and how DevOps can be used. So in that case, if you take any kind of product group, there might be an individual developer or a group of developers whose main work is to code or write program. So what they'll be doing on their daily activity, they will be assigned some kind of task to create or develop a product, and they will be writing program about it. Now, at end of the day, if their work has been done and if they just give it to the QA to test it, now, like this, individually, all the developers who are working on the product will be submitting the code for testing. So in that case, now take, there are 8 guys, like you guys are there, okay. So in a product, there are 8 developers who are writing the code. Now, 8 of you will be writing code individually, which means not all of you will be working on the same functionality, because given a product, they will be dividing or classifying it into components and based on the functionality, right? Now take, like, you're going to work on an application like mobile application. Each one of you will be given a particular functionality to take care, and it is working fine. So in that case, each one of you will be focusing only on a change which is required to bring up a functionality particular to what has been assigned to you. So in that case, now you say that one of you guys have finished your work and you want QA to test it. Now, if that is the case, what will happen? QA cannot test each of the changes what individually every one of you are giving, because in order to test, they need to have as a product, right? Because you cannot just give bits and pieces of a product or anything to work or to use it. So in that case, in order for QA to literally have a product for testing, they have to integrate all the changes and then get it. So now what will happen? There will be a person called build engineer, or among the operation team, someone can take care of the integration. But in order to do that, we have to put in a lot of waiting time, so that only when all the other required changes has been completed, they will integrate it together and then give it to the QA or create the product for further use case. So in that case, what will happen, each of the user has to put in a lot of time in waiting, even though they have completed, maybe they have tested the things that is working fine from their side, but unless and until they integrate every change and ensure that a product is created out of it, they don't know whether it is going to work in the product. So waiting period for each user will be more, and also the same thing for the QA. And let's take the scenario, okay, now we have integrated all the changes that each user has given, and then you test it and verify, and finally when you are trying to deploy your product, say something doesn't work, or one of the user who has modified the change was working fine only for his functionality, but when we integrated and we are trying to work as a product, then it is not getting, or it is not compatible. So what will happen in that case, we have to find out, putting in so much of effort, and who is the guy who has caused the problem, and send it back. So like this, the amount of time that has been spent in just going through this software development cycle is very high, wherein even though there is a small issue which he did sometime in the morning, only when it is getting integrated in the evening and the problem is arising, he will be getting it back on the next day. So the time which has been put into this life cycle is very much higher. And at the same time, now if you take the current market is in such a way that there's so much of competition and the technology evolving around it is so high, wherein people want to deliver it at a faster rate. That means you are trying to give your mobile application or your what kind of product that you have in the market, say that, okay, let me work like this very slowly and give a new product next year. Do you think people would really buy, because it is in a, such a competition world where people are trying to come up with things very faster? So it has been tremendous pressure on the developers to keep producing things at a faster rate. So what will happen now, along with the single product what you are working, there might be one more requirement for a new release. Like say you are working on a mobile application, okay, which is used for Android. Now this process what you're going to do is for Android. Now suddenly the company will decide that, okay, let us also release the product for Windows based mobiles. So what will happen in that case? Now a developer also has to work on the changes for the same product which can be used for Windows. So additionally, he can also work on some kind of other releases. Say that you have worked or you have given this Android for some user last month and they come back saying that there is some problem in it. So what will happen? Again, you have to fix the changes for that. So the amount of task which a developer has to work will be increasing slowly. So can he do all those things which is in his pending state parallelly is what a big question will come. So the time that has been put into work and the quality of the work to get the things done at an earlier rate is really high in demand. So this is the biggest problem what the development group would be facing. Okay, now on the other side, if you take, as I said, so to support this developers or to support this QA, now each one of them will be working on a machine. So we need someone to maintain all those things. So that is when we have the system administrators or the operations group who maintain the servers and ensure things are fine. Now what will happen here is, as the number of people or as the number of usage keeps growing, then the number of servers or the machines that is being used in the company will also increase. So what will happen in that case? So as a system administrator or the operations guy who is taking care of this, the work whatever he's doing will also get increased. Now if you say what are the kind of work that he has to do now is, first thing he has to make sure that all the servers which has been present in the data center has to be up and running. So when you say up and running, it is responsible for this person to make sure that all the servers are running. Because say that if you being a user, you want to use one particular machine to do your daily activity, and if that machine is not up and it is not running, then you don't have a work for that day, right? That means you are spending your time sitting idle. If you think in that way, then there is 12 hours or 24 hours of the time that has been delayed for the release. So that is how it is quite important on the system administrator's task to make sure that all the machines or the servers that has been used by the individuals is up and running. Now, is it the only thing what he has to do? No, because if you say each of the servers, there would be a lot of maintenance activity which internally that has to be taken care from the server side. Maybe you will make sure that the servers are working, but like taking backup, making sure of enough space is there, or scrubbing the old data, like this there might be many tasks which maintenance part has to be done. So in that case, for each machine there will be different kind of maintenance work. So as a system administrator, they have to write some kind of small tools or maintain all this applications additionally on top of these servers to make sure the maintenance is happening properly. Okay, now do we think is it enough only with these two? No. Primarily, if you think, okay, that a user is trying to connect to a server and it is up and running, and after connecting, he's trying to run his application or his task, and now say that it is not working fine as expected because of the server is not in a state to use. So in that case, what will happen? Still, the user is wasting his time or being idle. So what is necessary from an operations guy or a system administrator is that they have to make sure all the servers are up and running and also healthy. Healthier in the sense it is in the state which a user can be used. So it is primary requirement and necessary for a engineer who's in the operation to make sure all of them. Now the biggest pain point is that as the number of servers or the users keeps increasing, the amount of task which they will be doing is more and more. Okay, so now how we can solve all these things. So that is when development or this system administrator can be, you know, they can make use of some kind of practices through which they can avoid all this problem. So in that case, if you take DevOps, DevOps is not just a tool. Okay, DevOps is a best practice or a combination of several tasks using which you can improve three things in your company. That is the quality of the work and the time that is being used for the releases, and majorly the cost that has been involved in each and every activity or the problem that I've been talking. So in that case, when we see that for the development, we can make use of certain new or modern technology called agile software development, where what it talks about is why is that you have to work on the complete product on the cycle, what I was talking, like everyone work, wait until it is integrated and then give it to the QA so that there's so much of time. So instead of that, continuous integration as in a process as part of agile methodology says that we can break up the complete product into smaller chunks or components and try to apply a method wherein on a daily basis you work on each of the component within a specific time, wherein it is not the development who is going to work, but in parallel along with the development, all the other team who are going to work, like the testing team or the build team or the IT team, will work together and try to fix it, the problem, within a given time. So in that case, what will happen? The cycle of the development will be happening in parallel for all the changes. So there is not much time that has been spent for a user to integrate. So as soon as a change is done, immediately integration will happen, immediately testing will happen, immediately deployment will happen. So what will happen in that case? We can easily find out if there is a problem happening, and also the productivity will go up because this lot of time that has been saved. And additionally, we can always target on the exact required releases. That means now, in addition, if you say that, okay, you are working on some particular release, if I want to add one more release, you can easily squeeze in and specifically manage the time using the agile methodologies. Okay, now on the other side, if you take from the servers, because DevOps is going to focus on two things. One is improving the releases, and also the other side is whatever problem that we are facing in managing the servers can be overcome. So now if you think how we can overcome the problems in the infrastructure, then first thing what we can do is we can make use of something called as virtual machines. Because if you have all the machines as physical machines or physical servers, then the amount of time and effort that has been put into maintaining this and procuring this servers are very high, right? So instead of that, we have machines or products through which we can create virtual machines, so that what will happen, we don't have to put so much of cost in bringing up a new service. So all we can do is create a server whenever we need, and when we don't need it, we can just simply scrub it. And on the other side, if you think we can use of make use of certain softwares which calls it container ship, using which we can have the exact requirement of a server. So if you say that in this server I need only this, we can have only that rather than having it physically. And mainly, if you see now, currently they are thinking little ahead. Okay, even for a virtual machine, you need some maintenance, but even though it is a virtual machine, it will be running unnecessarily when you don't want. So that is when people are getting into cloud computing, where you are going to use it and pay only when you are going to need it. That means as a cloud, you don't even have to have any kind of software in your place. Just go to the web or the cloud, request for a server with all the details that you need, and that will be getting you. That means cloud is something you can either get an infrastructure or a machine with all the specifications, or if you want only a software you can take. Say for example that there is some licensed tool. If you buy a licensed tool, unnecessarily you will be paying money for every hour of where you are not using. Like you will be using it only for 12 hours. For the remaining 12 hours, no one will be using. You will be paying it unnecessarily. And also think that you want to use it only for 15 days. Then it is not like that you will be paying for 15 days. So there will be based on months for which you have to pay. But here, if you take the cloud, you can use a software only for hours or the day which you are going to use. So that will be very cost effective for the company or small organizations, wherein they don't have to pay huge amount in procuring physical servers or softwares. Okay. Now, on the further side, even though we are using different kind of machines or servers, from an administrator side or an operation engineer side, what is required is they have to manage and maintain all the servers, which means now, yeah, you have bring up some server which is reducing the cost of procuring, but once you get into this and start working, you need some configuration that has to be done, or it has to be on a desired state for which you can work. So in that case, developers or some person from the operation has to spend some time in configuring, but that is still a pain point. So to overcome that, we have certain tools called configuration management tools, using which we can configure or allow this CM tools to configure and make sure that whenever you want, the state of the server will be the same as it is required, so that an operation engineer doesn't have to spend too much of time in maintaining the state of the servers. Even if you have 100 servers, the CM tool individually can take care of managing all the state in each of the servers. And additionally, so the important thing is making sure that all the servers are healthy, right? So there are monitoring tools through which no matter hundreds of servers it can be in your data center, easily all these things can be monitored and make sure that there is a problem that is going to happen and try to fix it at an earlier state. Because now when you're working on so many servers, if something goes down, fixing is one of the things. Yeah, right. But fixing it after the issue has happened is not the right thing, because it is going to be a bottleneck, and until we are fixing, people has to wait. So keep a monitoring system to make sure that if you proactively try to measure things and say that, okay, I think this is getting the threshold limit and maybe we should try to fix it earlier. So that is what we can achieve for a better infrastructure management, wherein the cost that is put in procuring and maintaining these servers is completely eliminated, and also the effort in maintenance is also reduced. So now if you take to revisit, DevOps is actually, as I said, is a best practice wherein you will be putting in various improvement in any kind of activity that has been done by these development and the operation teams. So DevOps says that rather than working in silos or individually, try to act as a bridge between these two communities to ensure there is a proper communication and integration between this team. And mainly, DevOps focuses on automation. So it doesn't matter what kind of process or work that you're trying to do between these groups. So DevOps tries to say that, okay, let me see what is that you're trying to do and what is that we can improve in it. So in that perspective, DevOps is nothing but a mix of various activities. So with respect to each activity that you're doing in a process, it will try to give some tools and help the process to improve it. Okay. Now, so I've been telling so many things like, okay, problem in the developer side, problem from the system side, how we can improve and what is DevOps going to do. So now if you look how exactly you can improve it, as I said, so we have tools for each activity or related to each problem and how you can fix it, the tool will help. So in DevOps engineering, if you see, you will be working on a mixture of various tools because the process to work on something will involve some different kind of tasks to be done. So in order to achieve the automation of this different tasks, you will be working on different set of tools. Okay, so the very first thing, if you see, the configuration management, whatever I said, is the key role wherein we have to make sure that each servers are in a desired state. So for that, we have tools like Chef and Puppet in assisting them. And if we want to work on something called as container ship to make sure that, again, that on a server we need exactly the environment on which we are working, then Docker and Vagrant as a container ship tool will help. And for monitoring the system, say that your task given in the company is to make sure that the 100 or 200 servers are working fine and you have to monitor, then we will use tools like Nagios or Surf to monitor. And when you move towards the cloud, majority of the market towards the cloud has been obtained and it is being supported by Amazon Web Services, wherein they have a very good cloud computing system so that you either can make use of servers individually or you can get softwares based on your need. And in some case, what will happen in some companies is that there will be too many log files and maintenance activity will be required. So in order to assist that maintenance activity and reading the log files and managing the log files, there are tools like Elasticsearch and Logstash which will help to read the log files and store data from it. And continuous integration, when I was talking in the initial place, so Jenkins is a tool which not only works as continuous integration, but also it will be working as a framework which can connect all these tools and gives like one point of contact through which you can work on the complete process whichever is there in your company. And for all these activities, if you see, there will be little work in scripting and maintaining the automation tool, whatever you're doing. So you might be writing some documents, you might be writing some script. So where will you maintain all the scripts? So for that, we will be using some tools like Git, using which you will be doing or tracking the changes with respect to what you're doing in your scripting or documentation. And finally, as I said, DevOps is going to focus completely on automation. If there are any activities which these tools cannot do, then additionally, you can write some scripting through which you can achieve the automation. So basically, scripting will help to automate your regular tasks, whatever that you're doing it manually. So for example, that you have a file or say that you are trying to connect to machine to do something. One machine is fine. Now, if I ask you to connect to 100 machines and do the same task, you will be spending some time manually. So instead of that, you can write some command. Or let me say that you want to copy a file to one machine to other machine. Okay, now if I ask the same thing, can you copy 100 files? Then there's a lot of time that you'll be spent. So instead of doing all these things manually, you can write a script which can help you to automate the tasks which you are doing manually. Okay, so now these are the tool sets. Yes.
Actually, I also heard of some other tools like some Sonar, Cassandra, and something else.
Okay, so Sonar is, like I said, there's no limitation for DevOps tool. So we have more than 50 to 60 tools in the DevOps. So what is the process that your company is using, and corresponding to it, there will be a tool. So when you talk about Sonar, now there is a process in the team wherein they want to make sure that the quality of the code that has been written are higher. So that comes more towards the build and release management. Okay, now some companies, they add it as part of DevOps, but that is more into the build and release management. But there is no restriction saying that you should not be adding it. Like I said, for continuous integration, if you can do an integration quickly and test it, you can add that also. So it is not limited only to this set. That is what I was trying to say.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
So that is Sonar is a tool that is majorly used for static code analysis to make sure that if a developer is writing 100 lines of code, whether these 100 lines of code are really used in the product. Okay, so for that purpose they will be using. Additionally, as I mentioned, there are many other tools assisting different kind of tasks. So it is not one tool is used for one task. Now we have different kind of problems that is arising, then there are different kind of tools which will help to automate it. And that is what the exact first thing that is going to be explained. So if you are going to work as a DevOps engineer, the first basic thing what they expect a company from you is that you have to be a generalist. That means you shouldn't be just saying that, okay, I will work only on one tool. No, because there are different kind of problems, different processes that as a company is working on, then you have to be a generalist focusing on different things. So, okay, in your company you are using Sonar, then support Sonar. In your company, if you are working on Cassandra, then help. Someone says that I am working on Selenium for testing, can you help me? Yes. Be a generalist is what the first thing DevOps is going to focus. And continuous integration through which the release management can help, or the developers can help in maintaining things at a faster rate. And now if you see in the current market how things are working is that, so if you take this Flipkart or Facebook, have you ever seen them going down for new releases that they have to do, or for something new feature that they have to give it to you? Definitely no, right? So how is that they are doing? So they do using this concept called continuous deployment. That means there will be some developer or group of users who are modifying on some new release, and as soon as they do the work, they test and make sure everything is fine, and they deploy immediately. That means immediately that has been rolled into the production so that the users will start working. So there is no delay in saying that, okay, I am going to stop Facebook for 1 hour to bring down the new features. No, as soon as something happens in the development, immediately that will be put into the production, and that is what continuous deployment concept works deep. And on the other side, as I said, DevOps is going to focus majorly towards this machine or the servers. So monitoring continuously the servers is very, very important. That is what a DevOps engineer will be focusing on. Okay, and other than all these things, resilience is a key factor or a characteristic which a DevOps engineering should or a DevOps engineer should have. So what do you mean by resilience is, okay, so there are tools. So if there is a problem happening, try to fix it is okay. Now, how quickly can you respond to a change or bounce back to your original state is what resilience is going to talk. So you have to be a generalist and think about how proactively you can try to find out a problem, or if a problem happens, how can you respond it and communicate properly with the entire group so that the work, whatever has been done by other people, is not stalled and it happens smoothly. Okay, so that is the other important thing. And finally, as I said, automation and automation. So whatever process that you might be using, try to automate and make the best out of the process what it is happening, so that the time and the cost that is being involved in each of the process should be reduced. That is a major focus from a DevOps concept. So now, that is why if you see the ratio of people who are going to work on DevOps is quite increasing. And also, if you compare in a product or in a company, it is like 1:1 ratio of 100 of other engineers. So if you have 100 engineers, they need at least one DevOps engineers to support. So in that case, the responsibility of a DevOps engineer is quite high, and it is quite emerging, and almost like if you see, there are so many openings happening because of that, because it is quite mandatory for every company to have a DevOps engineer to take care of various problems that they have. Okay, so that is a short introduction to DevOps. So before I proceed on giving you the exact details of the course, so is it clear on what is DevOps and what is that you will be doing, or what is the kind of task that you would be working on? Any questions?
You said that we use agile methodology over here. That means, is it a combination of all these three: continuous integration, deployment, and monitoring?
Yes, so it is not that you will be working on only one tool. Like I said, it depends completely on the process. What is that you're working and what is the problem? So DevOps focuses on everything, but it is not mandatory that all the things should be given to an engineer, because it depends on the company. In your company, say that the number of servers is very less, but you are working on too many developers are using. So in that case, you should be focusing towards the continuous integration. It is based on the need. So it is not like, okay, if you say that every company should use a cloud system, no. It is depending on what is the kind of work they are doing and what is their problem statement. And for that, what tools you can use is what the task will be given to you as a DevOps engineer.
Thank you.
Yes. Does the use of tools differ from company to company?
If you think, close to 70 to 80%, it will be common from the problem statement. But using the exact tool might vary based on the use case. So if some people, for example, if they are more towards administration side, they will be comfortable with one set of tool. On the other side, if people are more towards operations, then they'll be using different set. But in general, 60 to 70% things will be similar from the concept. Like a process for which some activity has to be done will be the same. So what exact tool would be using, that might vary slightly based on companies.
Thank you.
Yes, sir, this is Jonathan. In the slide, you put the JavaScript scripting, no? Whatever the scripting is, a JavaScript or something like that, or it's any different scripts?
Java is a programming language. Scripting in the sense, shell scripting, Perl scripting, Python scripting, Ruby scripting. So it is not a program, but it is scripting.
Okay. The scripting also included in the DevOps too?
Yes, like I said, you will be working on some, it's not like every day you will be working on scripting, but some task might be requiring you to write some small script to maintain. So it is not like programming wherein you have to know the complete details. So it is more like I said, whatever commands or task you are trying to do, you just use the scripting, which is a low level of programming, to help you to automate it.
Okay.
Oh yeah, coming to scripting, what's the most commonly used scripting in the companies?
Okay, just a minute, I'll just come to that part.
Okay.
Okay, so now, if you let me take in that way, so whatever role that you take in the company, right, for a DevOps engineer, it will be majorly focusing on these things. So now, currently, if you see in the market, for servers, they are using AWS on the major side. Okay, so for cloud computing, you need to know AWS, because no matter what kind of company, they'll be using this. And on the other side, SSA, you might be using this or you may not be using, then there will be some servers, right? So in order to maintain that servers, you need to ensure that all the servers are required to be on the same state. So in that case, we have tools like Chef and Puppet. So to maintain it, they will be working on this. And on the other side, if you take, so I was telling you from the tools wherein you have to maintain all those codes or maintain the documentation. So SCM is a common task which people will be working. And for continuous integration, there are tools like Jenkins or Hudson primarily used. And for automation or scripting, we have Perl and Python on people would be using. Now, these tools are very common and everyone would be using, so that's quite straightforward. You can make use of the best in the market. Now, when you compare these two, we have a lot of choices and every tool serves the same purpose. Now, which one to learn or which one to use is completely up to the company. Now, for example, if you take configuration management, Chef is a tool and Puppet is a tool, both serves the same thing. But now, who will be preferring Puppet? So now, if you are an administrator already, and if you know things from the administration and your world is only administration, you don't like anything else, then people will prefer Puppet because that tool is little convenient for an administrator. Now, on the other side, if you take who are not an administrators, then someone like you or someone who is more into the operation, then it is easy to learn and work on Puppet compared to, easy to learn on Chef when compared to Puppet. That is how they will be working on. And the same way, if you take on automation or scripting, we have tools like Perl and Python or Ruby. Now, who will use Python? So Python works on the same way as of the programming OOPS concept. So if you are a developer who are very well versed with C++ or Java and you like programming, okay, then if you ask them, they will say always I like programming only, then I want something to do in a similar way. So in that case, they will be preferring Python. But it is not mandatory that you should be using only Python. And the other side, if you take, so we have Perl, which can actually help us in doing the same task, because we are not going to write a program in a level as operator, I mean OOPS concept to do something. What we are trying to do is something simple. So as I said, you have some task which you want to do manually. Instead of writing a complete program, we just have to automate by writing some 4 lines or 5 lines of code which is called scripting. So that can be achieved by Perl also. So it is based on the understanding and how. Now, if you go into a company, what they will say is, okay, I need you to work on configuration management and SCM and CI. So do you have a knowledge of configuration management? And in that, have you worked at least on one tool is what they will ask. Because since there are so many tools available in the market, it is not possible for each and everyone to get and work on every tool. So what primarily they will be asking is, do you have knowledge in any of the tool and in the concept? That is what they will be asking. So as a course, what we'll be trying to do is, we will be trying to give you all those things so that it will be quite useful, so that you try to achieve 80 to 85% of your work into this. Just a minute, I'm just getting a call. Hello. Hello. Keshav, I'm actually just in a call. I'll be just starting the class in 2 to 3 minutes. I'll be just joining. Within just 5 minutes, I'll just start. No, I haven't started the session. I'll start in 5 minutes. Yeah, thank you. Okay, sure, I'll do it. Yeah, thank you. Sorry for that, guys. Yeah, so as I said, we will be trying to cover this as the minimal. So if I say it is not, we'll be covering only this, we can do, but given a time of 30 to 40 hours, we would be not able to cover many things. So what we will do is, we will try to give this as the best so that 80 to 85% you would be matching with the complete requirement of the company. But in addition, if you have any requirement, then we can add one more tool. But now, if you add one more tool, then you have to learn and put in another 8 to 10 hours of time. So this is what the basic requirement for you if you're getting into DevOps engineering to learn. And additionally, on top of, you can learn as much as you want so that it will be better for you only. Did you guys get that?
Yep.
So.
Yeah, any other questions? That's a complete silence. Does that mean you guys understood? Having a basic understanding is very important, because all these things, whatever you will be doing, is that you will be working on Linux only. So as part of the course, what we can do is we can walk you through the essentials as in required. Like, for example, if you're working on this, there is some command which is needed to do some task, then we will go through that. So you don't have to worry that you don't have a knowledge, but if you have knowledge, it'll be better and it'll be easy to understand. If not, anyways, we will help you to work through that.
Okay, thank you.
No problem. Okay, any other questions?
Yeah, at the time of using some scripting and all those, when you're teaching them, will you give some basics also about those?
Yes, okay. So there's a difference, you know. I don't do the concept of jumping onto the tool, because I do understand you guys will not be from that. Say that you have already worked on something, then if you want to give something new, I can just directly jump onto the tools and give you. But first, the basic requirement for you guys is you should understand the fundamentals. So what we'll be doing is to go through all those things. We will be going from the fundamentals and giving you the details. Like I said, if I say scripting or configuration management code, you should know what is that first, what and all you can do in it. Then we will go into the practical stuff on what exactly it is and giving you more details on practical examples.
Okay.
And,
I
have a question.
You have given some goals and objectives, right?
Mm-hmm.
In those, actually, I have found like you're using Perl for the scripting language, like
mm-hmm.
for the automation. Actually, some of my friends are working in different companies, and when I talked with them, they told like many of them are asking about the Python. Like they're asking like they want to implement with Python, not with the Perl or Ruby.
That's not mandatory. See, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah,
if you guys want to learn Python, I can include it. It's nothing from my side, but what I'm trying to say is it given that amount of 8 to 10 hours, which one is easy for you to learn is what I would always think. And as I said, they will never say that, okay, you should be knowing Python only. No, if you say that I'm very well versed with Perl, I didn't get an opportunity to work on Python, can you give me an opportunity? So they'll just ask you, how good are you in Perl? Then, okay, if you are good in Perl, you can go ahead with Python. But if you insist that you want Python, then we can do Python. There is no problem from my side.
Oh, not like that, but I just thought of asking, because so many of them told like they are just willing to work on Python.
No, it is just, see, like I said, it is from who is driving it. Now, if it is from the development group who are trying to be a manager and try to do it, their mindset will be something different, and then they will say that it is Python, only by Python you can achieve. But what is that you are trying to do? So that is what is important. So how you defend is when you have the knowledge, you will know that and you can say that, okay, it is not just Python, but you can do it on Perl. But yeah, so to start with, what is your background? How easy is it for you to understand is what is important. So given that, you can do it both. But what, as I said, given this 40 hours of time, we will try to give you which one would be the suitable. Or if you want, you can learn both. It will be good for you also.
Yeah.
And I have another question. Are all these tools irrespective of operating system, or are they just based on Linux?
Yeah, so when you say it is irrespective of operating system, everything will work in the same way.
Okay. So we can use the same tools even on a Mac or a Mac platform or
it will be the same command. Installation will be a little different, but the way that you use will be the same. Okay. Any other questions? No questions?
No.
Okay, then actually even I have to get into other class I have. So if you don't have any questions, then let me end up the session.
Are you starting from tomorrow or when?
I'm not sure. You can check with your consultancy people. I'm just here to keep a demonstration so you can talk to them.
Okay, so thank you.
Okay, by the way, you can call me Adam. All right.
All right.
Sure, guys. So I appreciate you guys joining. So thanks for it. And if you have any questions, maybe sometime later, you guys can check and we can have one more small discussion if you have any questions. So thanks, guys. Have a pleasant evening.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.